Good evening. My name is Kadaria Ahmed, and this is Straight Talk. My guest today has worked as a reporter, factory laborer, and civil servant, but it is as a poet, dramatist, polemicist, and public intellectual that he made his name. Born in Edo State in 1950, my guest studied political science at the University of Ibadan, and it was here he first made his mark, winning the prestigious university poetry competition in 1975. After a stint at Oxford University on a Commonwealth scholarship, he returned to Nigeria shortly after the annulment of the 1993 elections. Apart from writing columns for many mainstream newspapers, he was also chairman of the editorial board of The News and Tempo magazines, who practiced guerrilla journalism during the military dictatorship of General Sani Abacha. My guest has held various positions in the Association of Nigerian Authors, ANA, including that of president. On Straight Talk today, I am very pleased to have with me Mr. Odia Ofeimun. Did I manage?
Ofeimun.
Okay. Welcome, sir, to Straight Talk.
Thank you.
Now, on the occasion of your birthday, which happened to have coincided just a day before the president inaugurated the national conference in Abuja, you launched a book that was titled "This Conference Must Be Different." Now, this conference is almost over. Can I start by asking you whether it has met your expectations or if you're disappointed in what has happened so far?
I always believed it was necessary to have a national conference. I did not support the idea of a sovereign national conference as it was being promoted by those who really wished that some solutions should be found to Nigeria's problems. I was glad that the president wanted a conference. How he could have a good conference really was a problem. There was no chance of having a good conference in Nigeria because no criteria for determining membership of the conference would be good enough for Nigeria. You can't use population because it is in dispute. You cannot use the number of states because that is actually the most disputed part, because states were created in accordance with principles that only the soldiers could decide. And you cannot deal, so to say, with civil society groups because they are self-promotional groups that are not properly constituency oriented. So you needed a style and a format for organizing a conference that would be all inclusive without necessarily being dependent on formalized interests. The way we have had it, in my view, is the closest to what can arrive at some good answer. And I am not disappointed at all that we've had the kind of arguments there. These are the serious issues of Nigerian life. It would have been wrong not to hear people expressing the kind of strong opinions they have on various aspects of Nigerian life.
But given the fact that it appears as if on the major issues that confront Nigeria today, federalism, issues around resource control, no sort of agreement appears possible, would you still be quite optimistic the way you were, before the conference started, and say that this was something good that happened?
I'm actually more optimistic today than I was before the president inaugurated the national conference. The reason is that many of the issues that have stalled Nigeria's movement into a better country have been raised in ways that require every other attempt at solutions.
Raised but not resolved. So we've always known the problems, haven't we?
But part of the problem we're trying to solve Nigeria's problems is that people take a look at the country and they are unable to see, to have a millennial view of the nation. A country is not formed in one day or in one fell swoop. It is by an accretion of various minor solutions that you come to the great and big one. If we are waiting for the day we have one big solution that solves all problems, we are not building like a country. What has really muddled Nigeria's path is that because people do not have a long-term view of the nation, and because they want quick and easy answers, they are unable to make concessions to the other party. They are unable to see that if one person was the president today from one end of the country, there will still be time for somebody else to have it. And so you hear people demanding a zoning system because they don't have faith in the other party. But if you have faith in the future of the country, you won't need a zoning system.
Isn't it a little bit hard for regular Nigerians looking at where we are today as a nation to actually have any faith in Nigeria? You seem to be permanently optimistic about this country, contrary to the evidence on the ground.
The evidence on the ground actually supports the idea of a country that will last. This is one country among all African countries that has spirit and energy in the way no other country has it. The nearest to it is South Africa, but we can squash South Africa inside Nigeria and still be able to breathe properly. Now, if you look at it from that angle, it is like what we do not look at. The differences that worry us and that we tend to bounce off and balloon into something really big and out of the ordinary is precisely why Nigeria will be a better country tomorrow. We are not going to be a broken up country. It won't happen. Many people who think it would are wasting their time. We are made up of different people who have always shared common moralities. I'd like to give the example of the Kola. We did not need a white man to help us decide that kola nut was something that we would use in various rituals across Nigeria. Although kola nut is more grown southwest than in most other parts of the country, the part of the country that actually does not appear to have a kola nut tree is Kola more than the people who grow it. Between the east and the west, they take the three-lobed and the four-lobed kola. In the north, they take the two-lobed kola, and they use it for purposes that are very common. If you were looking for fits of moralities, you will find them in the ways in which Nigerians consume kola. At baths, funerals, when they meet new people, when they are welcoming strangers, these are the very sinuous elements that actually tie people together. And so when you take a hard look at it, you will see that without the governmental force, Nigerians already had so many things that brought them together.
And this symbolism that you talk about as typified by the way we use kola sounds really great, except when you look at some of what people may say are the real problems. Boko Haram at the moment, real, tangible, killing people up north. Kidnappers in the east doing what they do best, you know, arresting people, holding them until they're paid large chunks of money. It is hard for the person sitting in Borno or Yobe or the person whose father has been kidnapped to buy into this optimism that you talk about without you talking about the sort of tangible things that will solve this problem rather than the symbolism that
examples. I'll tell you the way I look at it. It may look as if I'm jumping ahead of the solution that I want to provide. But let me tell you, this is why the Awolowo solution has always, for me, remained the central solution. Give every child education. Ensure that everybody who goes to school gets a job. Full employment is actually possible. If you look at the resources available in the country today, we have enough resources to make it happen. And then ensure that as people get older, they get old age pension. If you look at those three alone, there is no part of Nigeria that will not be affected by the solutions. The question is, how do you convince Nigerians who believe that they are superior to others that they should allow other people's children to go to school, to have jobs, and to be free and equal to them? Many of the people who become powerful politically tend to be people who probably never had any education at all. And so you have a situation where the man who was just a truck pusher the day before enters a political organization, and because of the kind of performances he makes, he rises. He may not become the governor, but he will become such a powerful figure in the environment that you must reckon with what that fellow does. Now, those people cannot be regarded as a class. What it means is that the basis for creating a moral society has been so shattered that anybody could climb up. Therefore, when people are talking about leadership, I always start by saying, no, don't talk about leadership. Talk about the answer that they ought to provide.
You've described Nigerian leaders in the past as, without exception, all of Nigeria's successive governments have been nothing but organized gangs of thieves. Those are your words.
And I think it can even be...
This gang of thieves, you're optimistic, can implement an OWO solution. This is why people don't understand your optimism.
Yeah, let me tell you why it is actually possible for me to do so. If a man becomes the governor of a state, the first question we ought to ask that governor is, how much of the goods and services produced in your state, how many rims of clothes can you produce such that we will no longer need to import it? And you can take the argument to almost every other good and service that is provided in that state. If governors think in such terms, there ought to be jobs for everybody.
But according to you, they're all thieves.
No, there's only one way of creating jobs. They simply don't have the crew, and that's what I'm about to mention. The way to create jobs is to build farms and factories. There are no other ways of creating jobs in any society.
Productivity, in other words.
All the other jobs that you find in society are derivatives from building farms and factories. We have been taught by the IMF, Kola creators, and the rest of them that when you do those things, you are interfering in the job of the private sector. Whether it is a government that does that job or it is the private sector is unimportant, as long as the Chinese say, it does not really matter whether the cat is black or white, as long as it catches the rat. If you choose to have factories and farms, it doesn't matter how you create them, as long as they are there for people to go to. Unfortunately, the way Nigeria is structured at the moment, governments are forced to have to do things that are not relevant to the creation of jobs. And we happen to have an economic team at the national level that is thoroughly incapable of thinking of jobs in terms of the creation of factories and farms.
And again, I therefore ask, if the people at the center don't have the capacity, like you've said, to create these jobs, how are we going to reach Nirvana? There's three things that people want us to do.
People at every level who can be counted upon. The federal government is actually doing better than most people give credit to the federal government for. Because we are so used to criticizing our governments, even when good things are being done, we shy away. Which was why many Nigerians did not know that the National Assembly had drafted a constitution for this country before Goodluck inaugurated the National Conference. But Nigerians had no faith in the National Assemblies they had elected or rigged into office. We ought to have, because many of the decisions they were taking were actually great decisions that we ought to have known about. So that when some of my friends or people I generally trust in society started opposing it, I used to go to them and say, look, why not first of all go read that constitution, see what's in it before you start attacking it. What Goodluck Jonathan did was to encourage the National Assembly and all those who were interested in a new constitution to go on thinking about it. He never stopped talking about it until the National Conference came. But because Nigerians always said that Goodluck had no clue, they refused to follow what was being done at the National Assembly. The same problem happens when you are looking at governments. Take Aregbesola. Aregbesola has this wonderful educational program which ought to be replicated in every state of the federation. Take, for instance, the Opoimo. Now, a different federal government, not too motivated by partisan politics, should just have gone to Osun State and worked out an arrangement for a proper factory to be created, which will be producing it for every Nigerian child.
What is this thing that you...
Opoimo is like a tablet that contains almost every shred of knowledge that you need in order to get you to a school certificate level.
A few years ago, you put together a dance drama called Nigeria the Beautiful, which went on tour in this country. It was largely seen as a reaffirmation of your optimism about this country. But then this year, you've come out with another dance drama called Because of 1914. I haven't seen it, but people who have tell me that in many ways, what it actually brings to the fore are all these differences that have made it really difficult for us as a people to move ahead. So there's a bit of a paradox in that you've now produced a play that may be seen as highlighting our differences.
Actually, no. That play is a very tricky way of trying to teach people Nigeria's history without making it look like history. Because of 1914 simply says we were conquered. How much of the knowledge with which they conquered us have we acquired so that if the conquerors return, they will not override us the way they did before? And I can assure you, if you answer that question, it is about how you create a knowledge industry for a country so that it is able to empower herself against all contenders. We do need to confront the problem that we were part creators of the weakness that made colonialism possible. And that is really why talking about the differences is something we don't need to forget. But what Nigeria the Beautiful is saying is that these very differences, which we consider the albatross of the nation, are actually what makes us the great country that we are. Anybody who tries to wipe out the differences is trying to destroy what makes Nigeria the most creative country in Africa.
We're going to take a short break. When we return, we get historical and discuss the Nigerian Civil War, the factual and fictional narratives, and what lessons we should have learned, if any. Stay with us.